Well, hello there. You're watching Go On Shaw TV, the Jane Austen Festival Edition. Well, hello there, gentle viewers. You are watching Go on Shaw TV. It is the Jane Austen Festival Edition because the first ever Jane Austen Festival in Port Alberni is coming up pretty quick now on the 8th and 9th of July. And we just want to tell you a little bit about it and who's going to be involved. And to do that, I have Emma Wall. Emma has a fabulous gown to wear to the event. And Emma, why did you decide to take part in this?
Well, I've always been interested in participating in different activities around the valley, and I just like dressing up.
And could you describe your gown to me a little bit? What color is it?
Well, I have two gowns. I have a nice green one with lace on the sleeves, and I have a brown one.
Wow. Did you sew them yourself?
No, I had help from my mom.
And your mom, Susan, has her own gowns. Two gowns?
I believe two, yes.
Now, has it been fun getting all of the things together for the event?
Yes, it has been very fun.
And what are you looking forward to first? Because there are a lot of different things happening during this festival. What are you looking forward to most?
I'm looking forward to the promenade around town.
Yeah. The promenade, of course, is when everybody in their Regency finery kind of walks, promenades. We walk proudly. We'll be walking down through Harbour Quay immediately after the Guinness Book of World Records count. And are you going to be part of that?
Yes, I will.
Yeah. That is the big showpiece of this festival on Saturday the 9th at Glenwood Centre. Everybody will be gathering, registering, and we're going to try to beat the Guinness Book of World Records. Well, you know, you might think that this Regency Fair, this Jane Austen Festival, was all about the ladies. Well, we're going to tell you about a gentleman who is taking part, who's into it in a big way, and will be taking his own lady to the Grand Ball, and he'll be looking pretty darn snappy when he does. The Man Cave, that sacred sanctuary where men hang out and do men things, like sewing. Well, at least you do if you're Bruce Proudfoot, who took up stitching about 25 years ago, by necessity.
Because my son needed a Halloween costume. And it was too expensive to go and rent one, so I bought a second-hand sewing machine and figured out how to do it.
Well, he did figure it out, and his Halloween costumes were often shared with the neighborhood children. But his current project isn't kid size. It's one that he'll wear himself, because Bruce is sewing his own Regency costume for Port Alberni's Jane Austen Festival.
I knew he would look great in it if he did it, and I do know that he can sew, so I was hoping.
And those hopes have paid off, as Bruce's costume is pretty much complete.
It's been challenging in a fun way to gather everything together and make these outfits while going dancing and getting right into it now.
Oh yes, I forgot to mention the dancing, because of course, a Regency Festival will have a Regency Ball. And although not everyone attending will know the dances, Bruce and Sandy have joined a core group, learning the steps so they can parade their finery at the ball.
It's been a bit of a challenge, but they've all tried really, really hard, and they've improved lots and lots.
Hanel's instruction has led them through the dance steps, and the Festival Society has helped with costumes, holding workshops regularly in the months leading up to the festival. But it does beg the question, what exactly is the attraction of a Jane Austen Festival?
Oh, it's a whole community coming together in something that's fun. And, you know, I didn't realize there were so many people that really liked Jane Austen or the Regency program.
It's just such a different era that we're representing, and where things were sort of, they had etiquette and manners, and everybody looks so elegant, and when they're actually in their costumes, it's going to look so much different, and it's amazing the poise and the posture that happens when you're in your outfits. It's just sort of charming.
Charming and elegant, a temporary step back into time. And as Port Alberni's first Jane Austen Festival draws near, Sandra knows exactly what she's looking forward to.
Dancing with Bruce. I think he'll look great. He always does.
The Jane Austen Festival of Port Alberni is happening on July 8th and 9th. For more information, visit their website. For Go on Shaw TV, I'm Nancy Wilmot.
It's gorgeous here, and behind me we've got some amazing kiteboarders. So make sure to get down for WinFest. So there's gonna be lots of awesome things going on. There's gonna be live music, bands, food, a whole weekend event of fun, good times. There's camping out here, there's no admission. So just come on down here, bring your picnic and some food, nice couple cold ones, and enjoy, because it's really entertaining. There's kiteboarders from all across the world that are just amazing out there. You blow your mind, so make sure to get down.
You know, my husband has been traveling to Nitnat once a week for years, and he's always told me about WinFest, but until I saw all those kites flying behind Alicia, I didn't know what a big deal it was. So it sounds like a great event. Who knows, I might even take it in. But before that, I'll be taking in the Jane Austen Festival right here in Port Alberni. Lots of events happening on the 8th and the 9th, and I'm here with Melissa Martin at the Rowland Arts Centre because on the Friday the 8th, there are some events happening here. What's going on?
Yeah, we decided to help out with the Jane Austen Festival this year, so we'll be having a tea as well as a brunch. Actually, you'll have to reverse that in order, but we're having the brunch right here at 11 o'clock in the morning until 1, and then we're going to have a little bit of a break, and then from 2 until 4, we'll be having the tea.
And the tickets are available right here at Rowland.
You betcha.
Now, this is important for you, even if you don't have a costume, because this is one of those events you can come out to, even if you're not in costume, if you would just like to see the spectacle, because most people will be in costume, certainly your servers will. And do you know anything about the menu?
I don't, but I'm certainly it's going to be a wonderful, wonderful spread of food. But what I also wanted to mention, too, is I do have a couple of questions, or they have been giving a couple of questions about the event itself and asking if they had to come to the teas and the brunch dress up in costume, and you don't, but it is a wonderful thing to do if you wanted to, but certainly lots of people will be in costume.
Absolutely, and there are so many people out there who just think it's a marvelous idea, want to be part of it, but sadly did not get their costume together in time. This is a great way to get involved.
Yeah, I think it's a different place and time, and I think certainly here at the Rowland Arts Centre it will be a beautiful place, and I think it will take you back in time to when it was in fashion.
Back in time, Melissa. Thank you so much. It certainly will take you back in time to a kinder, gentler, I don't know, perhaps more polite era. Now, we're also going to tell you a little bit more because there are other events coming up for the Jane Austen Festival. But before we do that, I'm going to introduce you to some folks who really are not going to hide.
Good afternoon, Peer Support. Bev speaking. May I help you?
Beverly Nelson is a busy woman, answering the phone and meeting with clients every week as she works at Canadian Mental Health in Port Alberni as a peer support worker, a job that she does well, in no small part because she has some experience with mental illness herself.
I was diagnosed with bipolar in 1999, was introduced to CMHA. And ever since then, I've been on the road to recovery.
Beverly isn't alone. The Canadian Mental Health Association estimates that 1 in 5 Canadians will personally experience mental illness in their lifetime, a condition that affects people from all walks of life and all economic brackets. People like Al Milligan, who became severely depressed after losing his job.
Val was around 2004, 2005. Things weren't going well. There wasn't much in the way of jobs. I did get really down and I ended up in the hospital.
Hospitalization and medical costs are a huge part of this story, with the estimated price tag to Canada's healthcare system at least $7.9 billion in 1998 alone. And yet those who suffer from mental illness are often viewed differently by society at large.
There's a stigma attached to mental illness because everybody doesn't walk a mile in my shoes. They walk a mile in their own shoes and they don't attempt to understand what I'm going through while I'm going through it.
So we just like anybody else with diabetes, cancer, lupus, you know, we're ill, we're not dangerous.
And it's that message, that people who suffer with mental illness should not have to feel ashamed or hide away, that has prompted the CMHA awareness campaign, Ride, Don't Hide, a fundraiser that saw thousands of Canadians take to the street with their message.
You have to raise the awareness. I mean, this isn't something that's going to stop immediately, you know. There's always going to be a need for mental health and fundraising, you know.
I'm definitely sure that things like Ride Don't Hide, Tag Days, people coming to meet us here, you know, and seeing us in our own environment would be amazed at the difference.
A difference in perception, a difference in understanding, and ultimately a difference in the way mentally ill people are treated.
Don't judge. Maybe care a little bit and go and ask if you can, there's anything you can do to help. Let them know that, you know, they're not alone, and, you know, just don't judge.
The Canadian Mental Health Association offers programs and information at their offices across the country. In Port Alberni, the Peer Support Program can be reached at 250-724-7176. For GO on Shaw TV, I'm Nancy Wilmot.
Cheryl and Jewel have a bit of a springtime routine. Jewel spends most of the day galloping freely in the mud, and Cheryl spends the afternoon cleaning Jewel up.
They're a lifelong commitment. Anybody that chooses to want to buy a horse for their youngster, think twice. It is a everyday onerous commitment. It's not just a ride and stuff away in the barn and give them a carrot.
But there's a good reason Cheryl puts up with Jewel's shenanigans. These two have been the best of friends for the last 11 years.
Her breed is a Morgan. She's a fairly laid-back, quiet, very kind-hearted soul. Having said that, she can seem to turn on the charm whenever it's necessary. If she's with kids, she'll tone it down. She also has some sassy attitude about her. So when she and I are together riding by ourselves, often I have to give her a little bit of a tune-up. So she can turn it on or turn it off, but for the most part, she turns it on.
Cheryl and Jewel love their rides together, but occasionally their trust in one another is tested.
Port Alberni is a fairly big equestrian community. A lot of people ride at tough facilities. Others, like myself, ride out in the beautiful Alberni Valley and other places. To get to these places, we have to ride the roads. We've had some difficult challenges. Not just myself, but other people have had some bad experiences.
Awareness between motorist and horse is very important, and the backcountry horsemen of the Alberni Valley want to bring safety to the foreground.
We encourage people to pass slow and wide, and most of the people in this town are very good at that, and they give us room with our horses. A lot of people have been killed riding horses on roads. I looked up a stat, and North Carolina, 20% of horse-related deaths are from riders on roads, or drivers and riders. with buggies. So it's something that we as horse owners are all concerned about and would like the general public to be knowledgeable of what we're doing and when we're riding.
The Motor Vehicle Act says a person riding an animal or driving an animal on a highway has the rights and is subject to the duties of the driver of a vehicle. And even though horses have a right to remain in the driving lane, most riders will try to stay on the shoulder as a courtesy to drivers.
Riding down here today, it took me an hour to get here and I counted 25 vehicles, and out of that, 23 were totally respectful and courteous, 2 not so much. It only takes one to make the mistake. And unfortunately, drivers as well as the people that they impact have to live with that for the rest of their lives.
More information can be found on the Horse Council of British Columbia website. And as for Cheryl and Jewel, they look forward to many more safe rides together. For Go on Shaw TV, I'm Jenny Fortin.
Gentle viewer, there is so much going on in the Alberni Valley, culminating in the Jane Austen Festival on the 8th and the 9th. We're going to tell you more about that, more about how you can get involved in all of the events. But before we do that, we're going to take a short break. Please stay with us. We'll be right back. Well, welcome back. You are still watching Go on Shaw TV, the Jane Austen Festival edition, because of course the Jane Austen Festival is coming up on July 8th and 9th. We are still here at the Rolland Arts Centre in the lovely Rolland Gardens. And Melissa was telling us about the brunch and the tea coming up here on the 8th. There's also an event at the Capitol Theatre that evening.
Yeah, they're having a reading from some of Jane Austen's books, and that will be at the Capitol Theatre. I'm not exactly sure on the time. I believe it may be about 7 o'clock. And you can come in, and that's by donation, and they're going to be reading excerpts from Sense and Sensibility and Pride and Prejudice. So it'll be a lovely evening.
An excellent evening, probably the best known of all of Jane Austen books, Pride and Prejudice, Sense and Sensibility. There will also be some authors in the lobby signing copies of books based on Jane Austen's writing. Are you going to be stopping by?
I'm going to try to. We have a couple of other events that are happening, so I'll hopefully make a little tiny stop in and take a look, because I think it'll be a beautiful evening.
It will be a lovely evening. And now, Melissa Martin, you got to get going, because we're ready to follow her down Art Avenue.
Welcome back to another edition of Art Avenue, coming from our wonderful McLean's Mill right here in the Alberni Valley. So I wanted to get right into letting you know what's happening at the gallery at the Rolland Arts Centre. Our current exhibit is with Don Bergen. He's a local gentleman that does animal portraits, some line drawings, so hopefully you'll stop by the gallery and take a peek at that, and that goes until July 29th. So certainly stop by and see his wonderful drawings today. And here's what's happening at Shara's Landing on Saturday, July 16th, is Heather Keyser and Steve Christofferson. They do a bit of jazz and French chanson. Hopefully I said that right, because it sounds wonderful nonetheless. And a bit of pop. On Thursday, July 21st, is Frankie and Jimmy's West Coast 2016 tour, and they are from Hamilton, Ontario. Sliding Delta, Demento Blues, and again, something that sounds wonderful, so I think you should certainly attend that concert. On Saturday, July 23rd, is Don Alder, Armed and Dangerous, Progressive Acoustic, Jazz, Fingerstyle Guitar. And Tuesday, July 26th, is Nick Sherman, and again, that is his 2016 summer tour, which is a bit of alternative rock, alternative indie folk. So hopefully, if you're interested in any of those, stop by Shara's Landing for your advance tickets today. If you like to color and you'd like to take part in a wonderful fundraiser for the Community Arts Council, this project is for you. The Community Arts Council and the Rolland Arts Centre are starting a coloring book. So we're taking submissions right now until September 13th of a line drawing. And we're looking for specifics, black and white, and it's a line drawing of anything that you might find interesting about the Alberni Valley. Something that comes to mind when you talk about this wonderful valley that we live in. McLean Mill, the Water Bomber, the Clock Tower, anything of that kind. We're looking for a line drawing, an 8.5 by 11. Applications are available at the Rolland Arts Centre.
Well, that's it for another edition of Art Avenue, but a few reminders before I go. Our summer teas on the terrace take place very shortly, and seating is very limited, so if you're interested in tickets for that, stop by the Roland Art Center, as well as our children's summer art programs, as well as our teen writing. So there's still space available at the Roland Art Center, and stop by for your registration today. So until next time, I'm Melissa Martin for Art Avenue.
Hello again. Welcome back. Today we have the Bard Lambda, and one of the sounds we have for that are tluth or pretty. Tluth, pretty. Or another word we have is tlishtlin, meaning your foot. Tlishtlin. The second Bard Lambda is glottalized and it says tla. And the word for that is tlisok, meaning the color white. Chu, we'll see you all next time.
We're here on location at the Alberni Golf Club because there is something big happening that you're going to want to know about, an annual event. Joan Hall, what is it?
It's the 23rd Annual Charity Golf Classic, and it's being held on the 8th and 9th of July.
Now, it's a charity golf classic for a reason. Bruce McDonald, where does the money go?
It goes to four local charities and Children's Hospital. It's our 23rd year, as Joan said, and we're over the $700,000 mark.
$700,000, that is amazing. And there is a reason why this has been going for 23 years. There's more than golf happening.
Well, it's just a great time. I mean, there's party afterwards, great meals, silent auction, live auction. It's just a full weekend of great times.
A full weekend of great times. Joan, who should come out? Is this just for golfers?
Well, the golfers are there to golf, but anyone can come out to participate in the silent auction or the live auction or any of the events on Friday evening and Saturday evening. So the public is more than welcome.
And I saw an amazing quad out there. Is that part of the auction?
It is. It's part of the live auction. It's been donated by Port Botos and Yamaha. It's a beautiful quad if you're into quadding. So, yeah, it's very well worth coming out to see these things.
Where can people get more information, Bruce?
Just give me a call at the Pro Shop, 723-5422, or come on out and just take, you know, we got the forms here. Come and see me.
Come and see Bruce. Talk to Joan. Find out more about this, the 23rd Annual Charity Golf Classic. It's a big deal. You're going to want to be part of it. Water. We turn on the tap and it just flows. Something that's easy for us to take for granted. But cities and municipalities who are responsible for that water take its safety and delivery very seriously. Port Alberni, for example, has recently spent almost $4 million to enhance and upgrade its disinfection system.
We only used to do gas chlorine first, which was our first main disinfection in the old station. So now we are generating our own hypochlorite on site here. Also, the other addition that we have here is the UV lights. So all the water will be treated through the UV first and then through the hypo system.
This secondary water treatment system brings Port Alberni in line with requirements set in place by the Vancouver Island Health Authority.
It's called 4321. It's a higher level of treatment required. This was an upgrade to their regulation. It's been in the works since 2009. We have worked hard to develop a program to achieve this goal, and we finally did it.
And
then this
is the China Peak line. And no small part of achieving it was paying for it, something the city managed without increasing taxes.
The work was financed through the Water Revenue Fund. So the water rates that you pay on an annual basis are put into a Water Revenue Fund, separate from general revenue. And it was that money that had accumulated over the years where the city has used to build this facility.
The facility is impressive. Today, a crew from the city's fire department is being given a tour, updating their knowledge in case of a call-out. But just as important as introducing emergency personnel to the operation is keeping the staff that operates the plant up to date in their training.
It's an ongoing training here. We've had training from the manufacturer of the UV system, also training on the hypochlorite system. And every year the guys have to go through training with the BCWWA to keep their tickets up. So it is ongoing training.
Ongoing training, and clearly an ongoing source of pride for the crew.
Oh, I love it. It is state of the art. If you look at this building, a lot of the lumber is from the McLean's Mill. Green roof on top. We even take the heat out of the raw water to heat the building here.
All of which means that city residents can safely enjoy that cold glass of water. For Go on Shaw TV, I'm Nancy Wilmot.
That's good.
Well, that does bring us to the end of the Jane Austen Festival edition of Go on Shaw TV. There are just a few more things I need to tell you about, though. The most important one is the Guinness Book of World Records Challenge, which is happening on Saturday the 9th at Glenwood Center. Now, it's important that if you're going to be part of the challenge, dressed in Regency, that you register. You can pick up registration forms right here at Rolland Arts Center, or you can register the day of, but I'm guessing there will be lineups. Now, go to the website, centennialbells.ca. Click on the Jane Austen tab, you'll find out what constitutes Regency, because to be part of the record, you have to be dressed in Regency. No hoop skirts, no Victorian. Regency is a very short period of time. High-waisted dress, you need a bonnet. Gentlemen, top hat and tails. Until we meet again, gentle viewer, get into your Regency.